so glad you all could be here. This will be, I hope, an informative and informal discussion this morning. And we're just so glad that you all could be here. I'm Eileen Chrysler, and actually I coordinate and oversee and direct our special needs program here at Temple Emmanuel. And we will have some wonderful presentations this morning. I'd like to just tell you about who our speakers are. Our first speaker will be Mary Klensman. And Mary is the area director of Joni and Friends, and she will be telling us about Joni and Friends. And then Tom Hudspeth is the executive pastor and deaf ministry director. That's right. And he will be our next speaker. And then I will talk about our program. And our last presenter will be Trocelyn Mitchell, who will be is a parent, liaison, and committee member, will provide an overview of HEROES, which is a program for individuals with special needs that has camps and other venues that we'll be hearing about. And then we will have questions and hope we can inform you of what is here. We have people here from all different areas. I would first like to present Mary.
I think my directive is to give more basic information, but let me tell you about Joni and Friends first. It's an organization, an international organization, started by a lady named Joni Erickson Tata. It looks like Joni, J-O-N-I, but it's Joni. And she's a quadriplegic from a diving accident 47 years ago, one of the longest living quads in the thus far. And but in her experience, she saw the need to make it possible for families affected by disability to be able to go to their faith-based communities and to be a part. And so one of the largest parts of our mission is to help faith-based communities develop those inclusive atmospheres so that they know the need to make it possible for families to participate and to become a part, and then help to build those programs. We also have family retreats for families affected by disability in the summertime, and they fill up very rapidly. The registration opened at 2 a.m. this year, and that two of our three filled within an hour, mm-hmm. and then the other within the day. So they're quite a blessing for families. It gives them rest, and their volunteers, faithful volunteers who help in these at these retreats, and make it for a incredibly blessed time. We also take wheelchairs to other countries. Each area office, Texas is just one of the area offices, and each one takes wheelchairs to a different country. Ours takes them to Cuba twice a year, and then we also have a family retreat in Cuba. And then we also work with different universities and seminaries to educate the next generation about the need to open doors and to be welcoming to people with disabilities. I think most faith-based communities have no idea that there's such a large population out there who have the need to be able to be connected with their community, their faith-based community, and need that support. But not only that, to be involved and to be able to take part in an active role in those communities. So the handouts that I brought you the overview of our organization, and just about Joni herself. She's quite an amazing lady. I brought you just an overview of starting a disability ministry. But you know, I introduced myself and got to know some of you by name at least, I've discovered that most of you are well entrenched. You know all of this, but I'm just going to go through, and possibly there's something that will spark your interest, and there might be some way that we might be able to help in some way. But in starting these disability ministries, it's important that people pray about it, and that God will open those hearts to see the need. And then to enlist leadership support, and from the leaders in your church to talk with them about the need and the huge population out there of people with disabilities. You know, I've talked with church leaders, and they think, oh, we don't really need to do this. There are just no people with disabilities in our church. And I'm thinking, well, they're not there because there's not a way for them to be there. And they just don't understand. We need to take the census statistics. We need to show them that there's so many people out there who, and they just don't have a clue. Then it's good to gather a diverse planning team. It's good to include parents, but it doesn't need to be dominated by parents. I think sometimes when parents are the only ones who are involved in it, it becomes really a burnout situation, and it becomes a very difficult thing. It's good to have their perspective on there, certainly, and it's great to have persons with disabilities on that planning team, and then professionals who were in your church, if maybe OTs or PTs or special educators, medical professionals of all sorts. And then to make that plan, it's good to assess your own, the people who you already have in your house of worship. There, I've given you a copy of a survey form. Actually, you can get it online, and you can adapt it to your own place. But one side of it, it's something that could be put into handed out at your faith-based community. And one side of it has to surveys to see if there might be people in your congregation already who have a family member with a disability. You know, as I'm sure all of you realize, that there are families who maybe take turns. The dad goes with the sibling to church or wherever, and then the mom stays with the person with a disability, and then they trade places. So families rarely get to go to church together, and so it's important. I'm so sorry. I come from a church-based background, so I'm going to say church, but can I just say that it's for everyone? Okay, sorry. It's just. But one side is for to find out, okay, how many people are actually in your church who have a family member with a disability who would like to be a part. And then the other side is a way to recruit some volunteers. Find out who might have expertise in those working with people with disabilities. And I have to say, it doesn't take expertise, you know that, to work with this population. In fact, my experience is that a lot of times it's those who've never had any experience with people with disabilities who are the best. Okay, prior to working at Johnny and Friends, I directed a special needs ministry at a large church, and what I found was there were people with great expertise there who maybe worked in classrooms, special ed classrooms in their schools. But when they came to church, they felt like that it should be like school. Like, you know, if the child was given an assignment to do, they should do it. And so it was those, I had to explain, this is not school. This is a place that we want them to have a great time. And so a lot of times it was those volunteers who had no experience who could come in and their hearts were so for this population, and they were able to work with them in such a gracious manner, and they got it really quickly. So I want to encourage that. But anyway, it's great to assess, to survey your congregation to find out who is there already, who might have a passion to work with this group. And you would probably be surprised. And I found a lot of times it's those paraprofessionals in the classrooms who have just some of the greatest expertise and the willingness to do that. So you find out what the needs are already in your congregation. Is it mostly for children, or is it mostly for adults? So that you can kind of start in one direction, so you're not scattered in so many. Is there just great need for a support group there, or perhaps those families already go to another support group, and that may not be the primary target? Is there just huge need for respite? I know that there great congregations that have wonderful respite programs, And there are churches, I have to say also, who will say, well, those churches are doing that, so there's not a need for us to, oh, the need is great. there cannot be too many places to provide these respite opportunities. And then during worship times, is there a need for how many, which worship times is it, or how many of those times are needed for these families to become involved? When you need a point person, if there are too many leaders, sometimes it's hard to figure out, okay, who's really going to take this ball and run with it. So it's good to find a point person and discuss and discover whether you can pay that person or whether that person, that's just going to be an unpaid position. And consider what the workers who will be working in that ministry, will they be paid or will they be unpaid? And sometimes there can be a combination of both. A lot of churches already have some paid people, maybe in their children's ministry. So it's not too difficult to add a few more paid ones for this ministry and maybe pay them a little bit more. Then look at the facility accessibility. And I've provided you with a church facility accessibility checklist just to kind of assess where you are. This is online, also on the Johnny and Friends website, and I've put that website down below so that it's not difficult for you to get. And then supplies, and a lot of churches kind of get, faith-based communities get concerned it's going to be so costly, but it really doesn't need to be so costly. You can take a lot of supplies from existing activities and existing programs. And I encourage folks to use things that are not costly because they are effective, like a big bag of beans, dried beans, and a lot of sensory things that are very effective and not costly at all. And then furniture, it doesn't really take a lot of costly extra furniture. If you really want to add things, you can put swings or something from the ceiling, but you don't have to do those things. Are there those little trampolines that people have in their garages and they don't use anymore that you could probably get, and balloons and bubbles and packing, those packing bubbles that are so wonderful. They're just things that are not costly. Then curriculum, the curriculum that you already use in your faith-based community can be just adapted to what you are, but there are others that are already in place, not very many from my perspective, but certainly it's great to adapt them where they're more visual and more interactive and hands-on things. And then consider funding and whether you're going to be a line item in the budget for your faith-based community. Is it, or if you're going to need to do a fundraiser, or maybe have one particular service during the year where you just ask for support for this particular ministry to be designated for that. And I have to, one church had a carnival that would come to town, and they parked it in their parking lot, the church parking lot, and that ministry got all the proceeds from that carnival. So there are all kinds of creative ideas to get funding. And then programming, what you need to decide whether your program will be full inclusion, which is always just the best, where you have a buddy to go with the person to their age-appropriate classroom. But that's not always, there are times that there's just a sensory overload, and you can have partial inclusion. And then there are those children, as much as you don't want it to be, but the typical classrooms can be so sensory intensive that it becomes painful and they don't even want to be there. And it can make them sick, literally. So it's great to have a quieter place, and even a place that's one-on-one, I think that's just a blessing. And I personally like reverse inclusion. I like having families who don't, even young children who don't have a diagnosis and who come into that ministry. And I've seen amazing things happen when those children come in, and the influence that they have, it can be I have to say, miraculous. I mean, I've just seen changes in students that are just amazing. And then volunteer recruiting is important, and I think even that survey goes a long way. There, I've stated some helpful websites that Johnny and Friends has the process map for starting a disability ministry and a sample church survey and this church facility accessibility checklist, and there are quite a number of other freebie things. There's some things to purchase as well, but there's some significant freebies. The Inclusive Church blog, Amy Fenton Lee does that, and she just has some great ideas, some very practical ideas that for inclusion and even some boxes, some helps for, toward transitioning kids from one activity to the other, just some great ideas. And then the PCA M&A special needs part, they have some free videos and audio information that's just great training. Then this next one actually is from the McLean Bible Church that's in near Washington, D.C. It's M-B-C-T-Y-S-O-N-S. But they have a lot of free information, even including children with autism into your faith-based community, and a lot of just some great, even in print as well as in video form. And then Stephanie Hubach is just a great advocate. She has a child with Downs, and she just is a great advocate in the faith-based communities and has some wonderful ideas. And I brought a few books that if you're interested to look at them, and they're to purchase, and I think we can sell them cheaper than regular for today. But I have Amy Fenton Lee. Remember I told you about her blog, it's The Inclusive Church, and it's leading a special needs ministry, and she's got some real practical information even about how to approach families who have a child with a new diagnosis or maybe a baby who's born. It's just a very sensitive, great resource. And then the Special Needs Smart Pages is actually started by Johnny and Friends, and it has some reproducible documents and just a lot of practical information. I think it even has a document for, I think both of these books have intake form information, because it's so important to have some sort of intake form for these families to fill out when they get there, so you know a little bit better, more about the person you're working with. And then this Making Sense of Autism is a video that Johnny and Friends produced, and it's just got some great information. And then Barbara Newman is an expert in autism, and she wrote the Autism and Your Church. And so they're available if you're at all interested. I will not push them, but I just appreciate the fact that you have a passion for this type of ministry. I have a son who's 25 and has real severe cerebral palsy, so my passion is here. And I have worked with families affected by disability for many, many years, and I hear them say again and again, I've been kicked out of five churches because of the behavior of my child, or I can't find a place. And it's just so important, and I just appreciate each person here who has a heart to make it possible for families like mine to be a part of your faith-based community.
Good morning.
Good morning.
How many of you know a deaf person? No? Okay, this will be a good... Okay, we've got two. I have two. Well, three. And my name is Tom Hutchbeth. I'm hard of hearing. I grew up in an oral environment. I was taught how to read lips and to speak, and then later I began to learn ASL. And my talk today has basically two stories. It's my story, and I'm sorry, I didn't mean to hit the microphone like that. I have to warn you, I'll be signing a little bit, because that just sort of comes out naturally. So, but I have two stories, my story and the story of Lover's Lane, United Methodist Church. My story is I grew up hard of hearing, but I was always made to think that being hearing was best. My parents took me to an oral school for the deaf before I was mainstreamed, and remember growing up thinking that, or when people would say, "Oh, Tom, you speak well." I didn't know that you were deaf or hard of hearing. I took that as a compliment, and I tried to hide any signs of deafness. And growing up in the late 60s and early 70s, boys could wear their hair longer than it was common. And I could hide my behind the ear hearing aids so as not to get unwanted attention. So I grew up with that kind of feeling of it's best to be viewed as hearing and not as one of those people who sign. My father shares reminded me of a story when we lived in Brooklyn, New York, going to a museum at the Brooklyn Museum, and we were out in the front, and there were these children who came out of a yellow school bus, and they all had these big hearing aids on, and they were some were signing, and somehow I just took a step back and hid behind my father because I did not want to be associated with those children. And so I sort of had that distance from the deaf community because I had this feeling of I needed to be, quote, normal, be hearing. It was not until I began to respond to a call to become a pastor, and I struggled with that because my father is a United Methodist pastor and I did not want to follow his footsteps. But after some many conversations in the night and prayers, I began to respond to a leading to become a pastor. And then when I responded to that call, the question then became, well, what kind of pastor do you want me to be? And it was here in Dallas when I was at Perkins School of Theology that I took an internship. I had to take an internship somewhere. I had to get some experience somewhere in my third year. And I felt that I should do something different, not go to a large church and be an associate pastor, which I do now. But I wanted to do something different. And I heard about another classmate who was up in Oklahoma where she was taking a ministry with an internship ministry with the deaf in Oklahoma. So I was invited to go one weekend. It was the weekend after Easter for a deaf rally. And it was there at this place called St. John's United Methodist Church that a man with overall beard and cap looked at me and through a sign language interpreter told me that I belonged with them. And I thought, I belong with you? why? And I'm getting this through the interpreter. I'm watching this conversation happen and then there's the response says, well, you have a hearing aid. Well, that was the first time that I had been told that I belonged because of my hearing aid. Growing up with this idea that I had to be normal, be hearing, not be viewed as being deaf, I'm being embraced within the first 15 minutes of entering into a deaf community that I belong. And so that began my entry into the deaf community. That was my invitation. And that was when I began to say, yes, I will go. And I will learn your sign language and to learn your deaf people. As I began to, and so that fall of that year, 1989, I moved up to Oklahoma and began to learn ASL. And I would sign some strange things as I would begin to learn a new language. I said things like, Jesus got tempted by the, well, that's the sign for horse, not devil. And I would say that that God had given us Christ, and I made the sign for Congress. So I had people who were patient with me as I learned their language. As I began to work more with the scriptures, there was a text that began to appear for me as a guiding light, and it's from Leviticus chapter 19, verse 14, where it says, you shall not put a stumbling block in front of the blind, nor curse the deaf, for I am the Lord your God. As I began to explore the word curse, which is in Hebrew, kalal. The word kalal, as we see, is associated with the other biblical texts. The first time kalal appears is in Genesis chapter 6, where God says, I will no longer kalal the ground upon which human lives. Now there's a movie that's out about that story called Noah, and as I began to explore the meaning of kalal, I realized curse is not just a four-letter word. It is a word that means being cut off from the ground which gives life, cut off from the ground which gives identity, place, and belonging. It is being cut off from that which gives your livelihood. And also it means being cut off from the faith community. The other place where the word kalal appears is when God tells Moses not to let those Ammonites or Moabites enter into the assembly with you because they try to kalal you. So there's an inference that kalal is also being cut off from the faith community. And so as I've wrestled with that picture of being cut off, I've come to see that the deaf community has certainly experienced an unintentional kalal from the faith communities. It's been said that 98% of the deaf are without a church community, and that due to language barriers and that sort of thing. And as I've been reflecting more recently upon my call into the deaf ministry, as I shared the story of growing up thinking hearing rather than deaf, I realized that God has called all of me, not just my hearing side, but also my deaf side, and that I am to use all of that which God has given to me. And I share that with you because I think that there are people who are not only who are deaf, but people who have disabilities, who are thinking that they are only part of a person or half of a person, and that God doesn't want to use all of them because they get the messages from our society that they're not complete or they're not whole. Lover's Lane entered into a deaf ministry really by no grand fancy program. But what happened in 1999 was a hearing dog came to worship with his his owner. And as there were some people in the congregation looking at what was happening, there was a small group of young adults who saw that, you know, maybe we ought to get an interpreter. Maybe we ought to check this out and make this service accessible. And they approached the senior pastor about permission of getting an interpreter. And they asked, well, we'll go research and find out. So they began to do some research. Meantime, there is a African-American woman, a wife of a Baptist preacher, who is attending a interpreting class at Collin County Community College. And she had entered into an interpreting program because her co-worker that she'd been assigned to was deaf. And so she's decided, I need to learn sign language. And in this process, she began to discover a call to interpreting. And she began to have these prayers such as, Lord, I will interpret, and it doesn't even matter if it's just one person. I would like the opportunity to interpret. And it was after one of these prayers that the phone rang, and it was from this woman from our church saying, we found out about you through Collin County that you might be interested in interpreting, and it's just for one person. And so she said yes and hung up and said, well, that was quick. And so on Martin Luther King Jr. weekend in January 2000, Charlotte Winters, a wife of a African-American and a wife of a Baptist preacher, come to Lover's Lane United Methodist Church to interpret. And she suddenly realized that she's in a strange environment. And so she began to pray, Lord, I need help with this music. I'm not used to this music. And it was about a month or two later that a lady came out of the sanctuary choir and after worship and said, I took some sign language classes in college, and I would love to interpret this music for you and help you. And so a partnership began for about 9 years between Charlotte and Kathy. Meantime, as we began to, as the word get out about this interpretive ministry, they put out a banner saying deaf ministry. I'm in East Texas. I'm serving a church in Marshall. And my brother, who's commuting in Dallas and working here, calls up my father and says, Dad, there's a church in Dallas that has an interpreted worship service. Well, my brother at the time, who wasn't going to church, who I sort of had written off as being lost, he becomes a messenger. And I figured, well, this must be a divine intention if he's using my brother to get this message to me. And in June of 2001, we moved to Dallas. My wife was 6 months pregnant at the time, and she never let me forget because it was in June and hot and all that, and we were moving. 3 months later, our son Christian is born. Only 10% of deaf children have deaf parents. My wife is deaf, and we had already had a daughter who was hearing. So we saw that as a confirmation of being in the right place, that as we were starting this deaf ministry, that how appropriate is that our child is born deaf. And some of the reaction I got from people was, oh, I'm so sorry to hear about your child, your son being deaf. I'm not sorry. I'm not sorry at all. And it was interesting kind of dealing with those kinds of responses. We did have Christian And we taught, we used sign language at home with Christian. And when he was about 5 years old, we came to a decision to have a cochlear implant. And that, but what I wanted to make very clear to Christian was, this is not something trying to fix you. This is a tool that you can use to communicate in the hearing and in the deaf world. And we still sign with him at home. I have brought some materials, and Mary, I'm sorry I took up all this table, but maybe during the break you could take a look. One of the things that we try to emphasize at Lover's Lane is that our deaf ministry is not to be an object of pity, but rather as partners in ministry. So we have a Sunday school class, we engage in mission. I have some sign language book from Honduras and other countries because we've gone to those places to serve other deaf and to send a signal to people in those countries that deaf people are of worth, that you do not have to hide them or be ashamed of them or to curse them or be seen as a sign of a curse, but rather that they are blessings of the Lord for whom the Lord has great love and concern.
I'm Eileen Chrysler, and we have my position here at Temple Emmanuel is to oversee and coordinate our special needs program, which we call LOMDEEN, which means learners. And I would just like to give you a little background on our program. It started several years ago when a parent came and said that she felt that we needed to have something for children with special needs. And at that time, special needs, the gamut of special needs meant a learning difference or dyslexia or attentional deficit attention deficit. We thought, well, that might not be, that's probably a really good idea. And she said, if we can get a class, she said, I'd be willing to teach the class. And she had some background, and her daughter would be a student in the class, and she felt that our classes were just, that her daughter wasn't really gaining anything from our religious school classes. We are a supplementary religious school that meets on Sunday mornings from 9:30 to 12:15. We also, let me just tell you that during that Sunday morning between 9:30 and 12:15, there is a separate Hebrew component that is just where they learn Hebrew instruction, and they also come during the week for additional Hebrew instruction. And we have, and that also has grown with our LOMDEEN program. And Zelda Lane, who's sitting right here, oversees the Hebrew component of our program. And it grows in coordination with our rest of our program. So at that time, we have approximately 650 children in our religious school, and it was, and I went through our roster and sent letters. At that time, we didn't have email texting. It was sent letters to the parents who I thought children would could benefit from smaller classes with modified instruction, and just gain more out of it. And we ended up that first, second, third year with, in fact, Madeline, who is another one of our special needs staff, you taught in those first classes, if I'm not mistaken. And we had that 9 children in a class, and then the next year we grew to 2 classes. And this went on for a few years until we had trends started changing and philosophy started changing, and inclusion into the mainstream classes started becoming the trend. And in order to do that, we started training our teachers to how to, initially when we told our classroom teachers that we were going to have some children with some learning differences as behavioral issues in our classrooms, they were scared. Teachers were, I had really handpicked the teachers, and they were scared to death. I mean, they didn't, they went, we can't have anybody in the class. You know, and you've got to realize that our teachers, just like Mary was saying, a lot of our teachers are volunteers. They're paid, they're not paid. Some are paid a very little, but they're, this is a secondary, something they do out of love. They don't do this because it's their day job. They, this is a Sunday morning job. So they, so we work, we have, we started working with our teachers and helping them with classroom management, helping them understand how to teach to various learners, et cetera, until it became, and we would, and I was, the, at that time, we didn't have a little staff. It was just, I'd walk into the classroom, teachers got used to my walking into the classroom and seeing how things were handled and helping the teachers, et cetera. And then this became the norm. And as time went on, the special needs population started changing, and our and the and parents started gaining confidence in our program. So we so many times until as you said, many times you don't know who people are that, that have children with special needs because they don't come forth. But parents became more willing and comfortable and excited about sharing their children's needs with us because they knew that we were going to use that information appropriately and have their children find success in our classrooms. And then there were children with autism and children that are diagnosed with bipolar and with name it, just what ADHD. I mean, we had one child with it that started in as a young third grader. That the first time that his mother brought him in the summer and talked, and I said, "Oh yes, we can accommodate him." This child was everywhere, and I thought, "Oh my goodness. Oh my goodness, how are we, and I'm thinking to myself, how are we going to accommodate him?" And we told her we would, Let's fast forward. This young man is now a high school senior, and he's in a classroom assistant, and he is as focused as he possibly could possibly be, but he's changed so much, and we have, it was just unbelievable. It's just been a miraculous evolving situation. And as time went on, also the other thing that Mary alluded to was, you know, you can have volunteers. We can't be scared off by lack of funds. At first we didn't have any additional funding, and then within the Temple Religious School budget, we allotted room for maybe one teacher, two teachers, and then we have Hillary also here who taught in the classroom and helped and was a person that was hired at that time just to work with individual children. We had limited funds. As time went on, and there are many ways to get funding, as I like the idea of the carnival in all kinds of ways. We were fortunate to have a donor who realized the need of our special needs, of serving special needs students. So we have evolved to where we have now a staff, called staff, a faculty, a loan dean faculty of about anywhere from 6 to 8, we have 6 right now, people who actually shadow specific children who could not be here if they didn't have somebody with them all morning on Sunday morning. Among those children that are shadowed, we have a child who is non-ambulatory, who is nonverbal, and he is. The person who works with him helps him understand, you know, she doesn't know what his receptive language is, is like, but gives him every opportunity to grasp whatever is going on with projects in the classroom, with integrating into a music group when we have music, and every type of possibility. We're continually trying to educate and inform not only our Lomding faculty, but our general faculty as far as teaching children with special needs and including them in the classroom and having them as part of the mainstream class. In my role on Sunday, I try to make myself available to help anybody that's in a perhaps a crisis situation or a one-time situation or for some kind of a lesson that's going on where they may need some extra help or observe children that they're noticing they really are having difficulty with. So as not to place too much of a strain on our teachers. Our time is short. We only have a few hours on Sunday, and even that is sometimes we don't have. Now, on our registration form for parents, we ask them to make us aware of any special issues that will help us educate their child in the most effective way. Said in a positive manner, it is nothing to cause anxiety for the parents, nothing to make them become defensive. It's just giving us information that will help us, and our parents understand that we will use that information in the appropriate way. And I think that develops over time. I think that as long as they see positive results, they will they'll come forth with information. At the beginning of the school year, when the children are placed in the classroom, I will talk with each of the teachers who has a child in the classroom that has either a learning difference or attention. This is all the information parents have given us. I'm not coming up with this information. And so if parents have given us the information, I'm free to give it to teachers. And I explain to the teachers how to take notes and what I'm telling you just for them and to use these appropriately. And if they need to speak with the parents, they certainly have permission. If they would like me to call the parents and ask more, I'm happy to do that and help them. I'm not talking about the children that have shadows. These are children that will fit into the classroom. And they go to so many different schools. They go from, we have just a plethora of schools represented here at secular schools during the week, including some special schools for children with learning differences and so forth. Each of our Loam Dean faculty shadows a specific child. They form a relationship with that child, and this is what Madeline, who's in here, she now does. She shadows a child with autism, and she speaks to the parents. At the end of if it's a new I've been very blessed that we have a Loam Dean faculty that has a passion and returns each year and have been for the most part with the same children as the children get a little bit older. We have new children starting each year and I keep hoping that we'll find wonderful new additional Loam Dean faculty to shadow these children. We have a child coming this Sunday, actually, to see the school, who will be starting next year, who is severe autism, and he has a service dog, and he's coming with the dog on Sunday, and his mother, and he's going into a class, into a first grade classroom, and I've talked to the teacher, and she has contacted all the parents of the children in the class to let them know, and first of all, the dog is supposed to be hypoallergenic, so in case anybody has any dog allergies, they shouldn't be afraid. It's a labradoodle, and secondly, it's the children need to know that they cannot pet the dog because the dog is going to be working, but I'm very excited, and I'm looking forward to this on Sunday. At the end of the day, and I've given you one of those example of the teacher, the Loam Deam teacher fills out a log, and from the questions on the log that you see that you know, he or she has asked the appropriate questions to the child and has observed the child during the day and turns that into me, and I look those over and notice if there's anything unusual or anything I need to, it's a red flag, or if things are going well, that's wonderful. See, that's the way it's supposed to, we should be. And we also, I think Joni had mentioned that, we also provide during temple programming. Well, first of all, I want to tell you that these situations with the with children, with the shadows and the children coming to religious school, have really opened up the temple to the families, because these are the families that where they would have had one parent staying home with that child and the other parent bringing the typically developing child, and this way everybody is. They know that the parents feel welcome now, and the children feel welcome. And in the classroom, this is a win-win for the classroom, because the teacher is enjoying and seeing that this works. The other children have accepted and respect the children that are being shadowed and have made friends with the child, and the child feels comfortable, and the parents feel comfortable in the synagogue, and that's what's important. So when we have program holiday programs or a concert type situation here, and it can get noisy, we provide a quiet room, and we let that and we send that out, and we designate the place for the quiet room and have somebody staff it, where anybody who would like to have a little peace and quiet can come for the whole time, the part of it. If they just want to have a child in there, there's somebody there to staff it, and they can work with the child, and the parents can go back to the program. Our Loam Deam faculty, we meet together a few times, several times during the year. I'm always available, but we meet and share any situations that have occurred, going on, and how our year is going, so we were a team. And also, flexibility is the key word. I think that's because, you know, you can have inclusion and partial inclusion. You know, we're in a situation now where there may be a possibility for next year where a child is not totally in the classroom all morning. Maybe only part of the morning, because wherever. You know, children grow and change, and their cognitive ability may reach a point where the information and what they're giving is not really helpful to them. They may need another type of situation. So we're open to that. We're open to change, and our key outcome is for the children to want to be here, to be successful, to learn something, and that's what parents want. They just said if they can, in some cases, they can come away each week learning one new thing, or feel comfortable, or saying that today is Sunday. Oh, I'm excited. I want to go, and that's what we're all about. And we have a child who started here, another one who's graduating this year. Gosh, we have a child who started here as a young child, and. He's also a child with autism, and he does have language, but he speaks in kind of a robotic monotone voice. And I remember when he was about in third grade or fourth grade, I remember going into his class and telling the children about him, and that he would like to be friends. And I said, you know, we talked about strengths and weaknesses and so forth. And it was so, I'll never forget this. And suddenly they all wanted to be his friend. And he was not, with this is with mom's permission, I went in there and he wasn't there that day. And not only that, but all the children started to, oh, I have this, my cousin has Down syndrome. They all started coming with, everybody knows somebody and everybody has a relative and they couldn't wait to talk, to share their special need. Anyway, that's how we started. And he had a shadow and he grew older and got bigger, older. And he had one milestone that we strive for here is to have a bar mitzvah. I don't know if you're from a bar mitzvah at age 13 or a bat mitzvah. He had a bar mitzvah at age 13. And it was, in my life, I don't think I will ever forget that day. Everybody, too much noise bothers him. Everything was toned down. It was just as perfect as it possibly could be. And he went on, and he got to a point in our religious school where he wasn't really gaining anything. It was too abstract for him. So we came up with the fact that he and his shadow, instead of being in the eighth grade or ninth grader, he and his shadow would become assistants and helpers in the kindergarten class, because he loved it, and he would go into the class, and the kids loved it, and he started helping them, and he felt so important, and it was wonderful. The following year, they went in, they did the same thing in a first grade class. And he's learning because these are basics, and about holidays and about the basic facts that children learn. And then his shadow, who is a teacher, and she's absolutely wonderful, she said that she would like to be a first grade teacher and have this young man as her assistant. So this is the second year. He is now her assistant. She writes, he teaches some lessons. He actually goes in there and teaches class and will teach a lesson, and he knows what to expect from the kids, and I think it's remarkable. He is graduating. I just got an invitation to his high school graduation, and he's graduating from high school this year. But these success stories are all over the place, and I'm sure every one of you that is involved in a program.
And he's in the same class as the child who is nonverbal.
That's right.
And who is in so it's all comes full circle.
And that is the class where and this is coincidental because they happen to be in the age group where the parent with the dog is going this Sunday, and so he knows about it too. So it just so happens. I mean, next year it would be different, but it just so happens that this is a wonderful way to start. So it's the best. It's anybody who works with kids that have any special need from it's a passion. It's not like you gain millions of dollars from this. It's something you do because it's part of you, and you want to do it, and you love seeing the results even in little baby steps. And that's all it takes, because you have to look at how much things have changed. And if you look back, do you see how far we've come? How far we've come in every way, in this, in all of us being here. In the individual children, et cetera. I think that's it. Thank you very much.
I'm so excited just to be in you all's presence. I want to say, first of all, I'm so excited because of the work that you do, the passion and the heart that you have. I have a son, Alan. He's 23. He has Downs. I don't know that I've been in a room full of people that are such workers, that have such big hearts and such love. And I just want to say thank you for being who you are in this world. Heroes, I'm a parent liaison for Heroes. We offer camps, spring, 6-week summer and Christmas right now. We are actually housed in First United Methodist Church in Richardson. Guess what, guys? That church charges us zero. I'm amazed in this day and time, but they charge us zero. They give us a place to welcome kids with special needs. They give us an opportunity to embrace children with special needs without the worry or concern of how we're going to do it always financially. And for that, I thank them for that. Heroes was established in 2005, partnering with First United. They started just over one break of school, and few parents got together. Now we service over 600 families. Over 600 families. What's so unique, I feel, about Heroes is we turn no one away. No matter the ability, disability. We have so many organizations, you know, that arms can't be open like that right now, but ours can. You know, we have a registered nurse on staff. If you can't walk, you can't talk, you can't, you know, whatever you can do or whatever you can't do, you're welcome. How many places do our kids have an opportunity to go to like that, where you're welcome just as you are? How good does that feel to you when you go somewhere and you're welcome just like you are? Just like you are. You know, the gentleman spoke earlier. You don't have to be this kind of way for me to be accepting to you. You're welcome just like you are. Heroes was the very first place that Alan was able to come. You remember the thing from Cheers? You go where?
Everyone knows your name.
Everybody knows your name. That's Heroes. That was Heroes for me. That was like the light bulb moment when I walked in there. We're going to camp. And it was like, hey, Alan, hey, Alan. He doesn't get that at public school. Everyone's like, Alan. He's like, hey, what's up? Hey. And I was like, oh, you know. Everybody knew his name. That's priceless for me. That's priceless for me as a mom. And the thing that we were just talking about, expectation. When we include them, let's have expectations for them. Don't just like, okay, well, here's this little poor Alan with Down syndrome. I'm so glad our church is letting him in, you know. No, have expectations for Alan. Know that Alan can do. I'm a mother of six. Each one of my kids, whatever abilities that they have, has to be maximized, including Alan. I'm not going to go like, oh, poor Alan with Down syndrome. No, Alan, get in there. You have a kitchen day. Unload that dishwasher. Does he have an attitude as big as theirs? Yeah, but does he still have to do it? Yeah. You know, he's real typical with attitude, I'm telling you, okay? He has a kitchen day, he does the laundry, anything. Did I look at him when he was born and going like, oh, you're gonna do this? Probably not. You know, I'm gonna go, oh. Then I'm like, oh, yeah. I've gotta prepare him for the world. I've gotta be able to help him to be strong. When those kids come to those classes that you all have, you wanna be able to say, you know what, you're gonna learn about this. You're going to learn about worship. Our expectation is that you really get to know, you know, who protects you, who guides you, who comforts you. You know, not, you know, you just kind of get to sit here and hear it. Figure out how they're embracing it, making sure that it's going into the depths of their hearts. And I think at Heroes Camp, that we're passionate about that. I believe that each one of us has a ministry. We're here. Our walk, our lives are our ministry. We are attached to some organizations, but we have the privilege of ministering all the time. And what I hear out of all I've heard today is one of the greatest commandments we're all trying to do is to love. We're all trying to love, you know, and we don't have a label on how that love is to be given or who it's to be given to. We want to give it to all men, all men. So at Heroes Camp, we try to, as our mission, first of all, is to love them all through embracing everyone. We offer SIB shops for the siblings of kids with disability, and just found out this young lady's organization actually sponsored Heroes, Josh and Kim, in going to get the accreditation to offer it. So I thank you for that. You know, now they can reach out to a different population of kids and support the family. You know, one little kid said, I'm doing one SIB shop. I think my brother is going to break our family apart. How grateful I am to be on that journey, to be able to be a listening ear, to kind of guide that thought. You know, that's what Heroes provides. Also, we do monthly retreats, you know, where the guys have a day and the girls have a day per month where they come for the entire weekend. First United supports that. They have a little house behind the church where we get to do that there for those kids. We have 12 boys hanging out from Friday to Sunday. So the parents have an opportunity to reconnect, you know, without as much diversion or just a little bit more peace in the weekend for them to connect. So we're really adamant about supporting that for them. A lot of times I find that homes are lacking the discipline that's needed, you know. So we want to embrace them. So what Heroes does is in-home training. You know, we get back to the basis of parenting, you know, making sure that discipline is an act of love. Setting boundaries is an act of love. And too many of our families are not loving our kids in the way that they need to be loved with having boundaries and discipline. So one of the good works that Heroes does, actually they go in and help with training the parent, which is a point of empowerment. As well, another thing that they offer, trying to make sure I hit everything, what we're working toward offering now is a full-time rehabilitation. We're having issues with our kids in Heroes actually aging out of school. And guess what? They have no place to go, really. You know, especially if a lot of the day habs, they have behavioral issues. Like, they're runners. Like, oh no, well, so Heroes like, okay, some of our classes we have probably 3 teachers to 2 students or 5 teachers to 3 students, just because the need is there. The need is there. We work with, most of the teachers are special ed teachers. One of the requirements of HEART is that you do have expectation. You know, we were talking earlier that we want inclusion. But with inclusion comes responsibility too, you know, of that child, of that teacher to know to have expectations. You know, don't just get them in there and let them sit. You know, really know that maximize their ability to learn. Maximize their opportunity to be with you. You know, like I was saying earlier, this is a ministry for all of us. All of us daily need to practice giving out love in a way that helps someone to grow. We also offer a parent connection program. That program, the first program, was a kind of a support group that talked to the parents about taking care of themselves. You know, how often do they get to hear, well, you should take care of yourself, and we encourage you to do that, you know. And the second one was on motivation. What's the greatest motivation? What is one thing that parents are doing right that they don't acknowledge themselves? And the one thing that they do right is they don't give up. And we commend them for that. It's not always easy, guys, and that's why they need your support. That's why they need to be able to come to their place of worship as a sanctity that's accepting of all their whole family. They don't give up. They need our support in our community. They need their place of worship to be a sanctuary where they can come and feel good about their whole family being there. The third one that we did was on behavior and discipline. Life sometimes is a lot harder for us as parents because we look at our kid with special needs and think that, oh, they can't do, or I'm not going to press them this hard. But we want to begin to say that help them maximize all that they can be. You know, we want to help educate our parents and empower them to know that our kids can be so, so very impactful to this world. Not just because they have a disability, but because they have abilities. And I want to encourage us as a community to welcome that. Welcome, see them in the framework that of what they have and not just what they don't have, but what they do have and what we can help maximize for them. I think Heroes is a huge ministry. I think the way that First United has partnered with them, you know, I think it's important that we do create that sanctuary where they can come for worship. Also, I think it's important if we can be something like First United that had church has been to us, where you can welcome a space. You know, sometimes these people come with their own group, their own volunteers. If you can welcome a space where that community, that neighborhood knows we're going to have this kind of function here at our church, it's the beginning of really tapping into a ministry and being able to have them know that this is a reflection of who this church is. You know, we welcome this. You know, we welcome you all coming. And that's another, just really a really big draw. You know, you may not have the staff or, you know, everything, but you may have the space, you know. And that space, a lot of times when that happens, when you open your hearts that way, it can grow into a ministry. And it can start opening the eyes of your congregation, you know, to, amen. Yeah, it opens the eyes of your congregation that, you know, this is how we love. You know, we're not commanded to love just this kind. We're not commanded to love when it's just easy. We're not commanded to love when it's just my kind. We're commanded to love. We're commanded to love. And as I was saying earlier, it is my honor and privilege to be in a room with you all, because you all get to daily practice it. You get to daily welcome your hearts to people with different abilities. But I want you to always remember, truly, 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 they have abilities. HERO stands firm in offering support to the family and to the child to recognize that on our watch, they will maximize their ability. And I thank you for being here, and I'm excited again to be in your presence.